Yeah, so I'm here today to talk about reading, and I'm going to talk about writing systems, not so much about culture. I'm not sure why I threw that in there. I probably meant to say how do writing systems and culture and age influence how we read. So if you're real interested in culture, you won't hear much useful. I will talk about writing systems. And I do believe that at some higher level in the processing system, when people can make conscious strategies about what they're doing, that culture has an influence. But at a level of consciousness and awareness that I usually deal with, I think that there isn't a lot going on there, that people are doing very similar things, and I'll try and document that in terms of writing systems. Sometimes people ask me, why are you interested in studying the reading process? And I think there's no better answer to this question than something that E.B. Huey wrote in 1908. Edmund Burke Huey was a contemporary of James. He was a professor at Harvard, president of the APA at one point. And he said, if we can figure out what people are doing when they're reading, we'd pretty much understand the human mind, as well as unravel the tangled story of the most remarkable specific performance that civilization has learned in all of its history. I use eye movements to study the reading process. There are other ways to study reading, of course. But where readers fixate, which words they skip, which words they regress to, where they land in words, and how long they fixate on words, provides a great deal of useful information about moment-to-moment processing during reading. The fact that, right, as John implied, readers get information from a word before they fixate that word, and they continue processing the word after they fixate it, separates research like I do on eye movements from a lot of other work that's done by people working on reading, using lexical decision and naming tasks and various other things. Of course, lexical decision takes about 600 milliseconds, naming takes about 500 milliseconds, and readers typically look at words for about 250 milliseconds. So that's quite there's quite a bit of difference there. In this talk, I'm going to talk, first of all, I don't have it on the outline, but I am going to talk about research that we've done with skilled college-age readers to find out quite a bit of information about the reading process. Then I'll talk about Chinese readers, beginning readers, older readers, and end with a very brief statement about some research we're doing lately on deaf reading. Intermixed in the talk is going to be a lot of stuff that's old. But this is sort of needed for the background information. And then in addition, I'm going to provide, as I go along, some more recent data and recent experiments as well. Okay, let's start with a bit of background then. Skilled college aid readers, their average eye fixation durations are typically around 225 to 250 milliseconds. Important to note that that's an average. Doesn't mean that every time a reader fixates, the fixation is for that long. There's some that'll be as short as 50 or 60 milliseconds, and then some will be as long as 500 milliseconds. There's quite a bit of variability in terms of how long people look at words, and much of this variability is telling us a lot about the ease or processing difficulty people are having processing words as they move their eyes across the page. The average saccade length is about 7, 8, 9 characters, but again, this is an average, and sometimes the eyes only move one character. When things are really tough and you're having a hard time understanding the text, saccades get very short. And there can also be some very long saccades as well. These long saccades tend to follow after you've made a regression. In other words, about 20% of the time, we make regressions where we look back in the text to reread information that we've read before. And then when your eyes come forward again, you typically go way past where you started when you made the regression so that you end up with some saccades that are 15 to 20 characters. But the average is about 7 to 9. I just said this, we look back in the text 10, 15%, maybe I said 20. It depends on how hard the text is, but across lots of texts, that would be the average rate at which people make a regression. We don't invariably fixate every word. We skip about 25 to 33% of the words, and words that are short and high frequency and highly predictable in text are the words that get skipped a lot. consistent with what I said a few minutes ago. There's also preview benefit as we read. If we get a valid preview of a word before we look at it, then the amount of time that we have, so if the word to the right of where we're looking contains a valid preview, we'll look at that next word for about 20 to 40 milliseconds less than if we didn't have a valid preview of it, because we masked it or something like that, made it impossible for you to read it. I should also mention that there's a poor reader contrast here for virtually every one of these measures. There are differences in the sense that people who are not so good at reading will have much longer fixation durations on the order of 300 to 400 milliseconds. Therefore, its CAD length will be more like 4 or 5 characters. They'll regress a lot, 30% and 40% of the time. Don't skip words as much, and their preview benefit effect, if it exists, is largely attenuated. Okay, a bit more background. We spent a lot of time early on in my career, and then more recently, we've been doing a lot of experiments with examining the perceptual span. So it's important that you understand what the perceptual span for skilled readers of an alphabetic writing system looks like. It extends about 3 or 4 characters to the left of fixation to about 14 or 15 spaces to the right of fixation. Another way to characterize this is it extends from the beginning of the currently fixated word to about 2 to 3 words to the right of fixation, depending on the length of the words in the sentence. And how do we know this? From experiments like this, where we monitor eye fixations of people and give them a window of normal text. In this particular window, the reader gets to see 6 characters to the left of fixation and 6 characters to the right. So they have a 13-character moving window. You'll notice that in this example, the spaces are filled between the X's. So when the reader moves, it's going to point down there, but that won't do you any good, will it? So when the reader moves from here over to here, the window moves with their eyes. Wherever they look, the window moves. If they look back in the text, the window goes back there. Wherever they choose to go, they get 13 characters. And here's a third fixation on the line. And so what we're going to do is make this window either very small, and we've made it as small as 1 character, so you're reading letter by letter, or we make it large. And the goal in the experiment is to figure out how large does the window have to be for people to read normally. And the answer, well, the answer is coming in 1 second. Here's another example. In this example, you'll notice that the spaces between the words are left in place. If you look carefully at this versus the example I showed before, you should see that this is easier to read because you get some information about where the words are that are coming up next in the text, which you don't have when the spaces are filled in. So what's the answer to the question of how much information you get? This effect has been replicated now across many, this is a paper published in Science a number of years ago. This effect has been replicated many times. Basically what happens is you start out with a 1-character window. That's really hard. It doesn't feel like reading. It feels like problem solving. You get 1 letter. We force you into letter by letter reading, and you have to combine the letters together to make a word, and this is sort of very hard for people to do. When the window is about 14 or 15 characters to the right of the fixation, you don't read any differently than when the entire text is present. And as I said, this has been replicated many times across many different alphabetic writing systems. So if you get 3 or 4 characters to the left, as we discovered in later experiments, or 14 or 15 to the right, you read the same as when there's no window at all and text is normal. This is largely an attentional thing, also related to acuity. One of my former graduate students, Sarah Serino, did this clever experiment where on each fixation, the characters got larger as you moved away from the fixation point. And every time you moved your eyes, this kept happening. And they found that still, the perceptual span was about 14, 15 characters to the right. It's being driven by attentional factors largely. The larger characters were off to offset the acuity limitations and didn't. We also know that it's due to attention because the span is asymmetric in the other direction for readers of Hebrew and other readers of Arabic, for example, who read from right to left. So the perceptual span It's also there are other ways in which it's influenced, and I'm going to come to Chinese in just a second, but the writing system does have an influence. Another paradigm that we developed is just the opposite of the moving window. We called it a moving mask. And so on each fixation, wherever your eyes go, a mask goes with you. In this particular case, the mask is three characters. So the three characters in the center of your vision get masked. And everywhere your eyes go, the mask goes with you. Your tendency as a subject in the experiment is to want to beat the mask. Get your eyes somewhere fast as you can. It doesn't work that way because we can sample the eye position so rapidly and make the display change so fast that when your eyes get to your new position, that stinking mask is there still. And so people have to try and adapt to reading with that three-character mask, seeing what they can pick up outside of the masked area. And also from the Science article, what you see is the top line represents the number of words that you can recall. Top line on the bottom panel, this one, my hand is very still there. This one represents, and in this experiment, people were asked to read sentences, and we asked them, what was the sentence, did the sentence say? And these are the number of words they can read from the sentence. So when there's no mask, they can read, they remember about 98% of the words. And that holds true for the one and three character masks as well. But look, this line is showing you the reading rate. So if you're reading around 300 words a minute in the normal condition, masking the character in the center of vision drops your reading rate in half. And masking the three characters drops it off of a lot as well. And when the fovea is filled, so for this text, three or four characters equals 1 degree of visual angle. So with a seven character mask in this particular experiment, foveal vision was completely masked. And what you see here is the reading rate is really low. It's down like the one word per window in the moving window experiments. And again, it doesn't feel like reading. It feels like problem solving. We asked people what they thought the sentences said. Subject had, and we let them make up to 100 fixations on the sentence before we took it away from them. And the subject said, made 100 fixations on the sentence and reported, well, they said, the priest brought much ammunition. The sentence really said, the pretty bracelet attracted much attention. If you think about the difference between those two sentences, you can see that people are trying to get whatever information they can, largely information about short words and beginning and ending letters of words, and trying to figure out what the sentence says on the basis of that information. I'm going through these techniques that we've developed before I quickly get to Chinese and older readers and kids, because I'm going to be using all of these paradigms with these other populations as well. So another technique we developed is called the boundary paradigm. What happens here is that there's a sentence and there's a target word over here. when the reader's eye crosses a boundary location just in front of tune, the sentence changes so that the target word tune change, so that, sorry, the preview word tune changes to the target word song. And then we look to measure to see how long do you look at song as a function of what was there before and how far away the eyes were. And this is where we get information about preview benefit. This is how we know that there's about a 20 to 40 millisecond savings if you've had a valid preview of the word that's coming up. Okay. For skilled readers, fixation time varies a lot as a function of word frequency, predictability, age of acquisition, familiarity. All of these variables will influence how long people look at words, and this ends up with them reading about 250 to 350 words per minute. That last bit of background information I'm going to give you is called the disappearing text study. This one kind of dazzled me a little bit. Well, they all dazzled me in some way, but this one is quite interesting. We found that if people get to see the word that they are fixated on for 50 or 60 milliseconds before it disappears, reading is normal, and the word frequency effect is still present. So here's the disappearing text paradigm. Your eyes are going along. Every word that you look at is going to go away after 50 or 60 milliseconds. We used a wide range of time intervals, but the one that turned out to be the lowest was about 40 or 50 milliseconds. After 50 milliseconds of looking at bracelet, it goes away. And it doesn't come back again until you move your eyes somewhere else in the sentence, okay? Refixating in that blank area or masked area, because we sometimes use a mask, doesn't do you any good. You have to move away from it. And what happens in the experiment? If the fixated word is there, like I said, for 50 or 60 milliseconds, people read quite normally. They know the mask is coming on or the text is going away, but it doesn't bother their reading rate or comprehension at all. And the word frequency effect is still there. So even though the word that you were looking at is not there after 50 milliseconds, how frequent that word is still influences how long the eyes stay there. That doesn't mean you got the meaning of the word in 50 milliseconds. It means that you got the information into your system so the brain can do its operations on that word. And the less frequent the word is, the longer the eyes are going to stay in place. Interestingly, if we muck up the word to the right of fixation, that really slows people down. They don't like that. Meaning, of course, they're usually wanting to shift their attention rightward to the next word that's coming up. And when that isn't there, that slows them down. So just a quick interim summary. College-age readers go about 250 to 350 words a minute. The perceptual span is 3 to 4 letters left, 14 or 15 to right. Preview benefit, 40 to 50 milliseconds for valid previews. And fixation time is strongly influenced by the ease of processing the fixated word. Okay. I'm only going to mention this here briefly, but it's important that, I'd been doing this research for a long time, and somebody once asked me if we had a computational model of of how these eye movements work during reading, and I said no, but then it occurred to me, we probably have enough information that we ought to be able to do this, and so we developed with Eric Reichel, who was a graduate student at the time, and Sandy Polacek and Don Fisher, the Easy Reader model, which is a computational model designed to account for how the eyes move during reading. It accounts for most of the important benchmark facts. It also has stimulated a lot of other models. So I think one success of a model is, well, traditionally we judge models to be successful if they stimulate a lot of research and also if they stimulate a lot of competitor models. And we've certainly stimulated a lot of competitor models. But our model also counts for much of the data and count for all of the kind of data that I'm going to be talking about henceforth. I'm not going to go into it because it takes a bit of time to explain it. I just want to put it on the screen as evidence that we do have such a model. And if you want to read about it, there are 2 or 3 psych review papers, a developmental, there's a lot of papers about the model. Okay, let's turn to Chinese readers. I think it's important to get data on Chinese readers since a large portion of the world's population read this particular language. I was just in Beijing for a couple of weeks, and there's lots, and there was a conference there on eye movements, and there were about 400 people there, a lot of interest in China. I've had a couple of graduate students and postdocs from China, and I always tell them, don't just replicate things that have been done in English with Chinese. Go up, there's a lot of interesting characteristics of Chinese. Let's find out what's important about them. Of course, you want to replicate the things, and we did that early on. We showed that there are word frequency and word predictability effects with Chinese and so forth, but there's a lot of interesting aspects of Chinese, which I'm going to run through right now. I think it's an interesting test case then with respect to English. It's also interesting to see if the models can account for the data. Now, this is something you could buy off the street. It's got these chop marks on it. It's a bunch of Chinese characters. If you read Chinese, you might recognize a lot of these characters. There's about 5,000 Chinese characters. It keeps students in China quite busy memorizing all of these characters over their elementary school years. Here's a paragraph written in Chinese. You can see that there are a couple of Roman digits in there, but one thing is the text is all strung together, right? There are no spaces between the words. There's an extra space when there's a period, but by and large, there's not. Here's a sentence where, let's go back. Okay, so Chinese is read from right to left, left to right. used to be read up and down, but it's now in mainland China, it's always read from left to right. Characters stay within equally spaced boxes, but there are no spaces between the words. The sentence, her face turned red because of shyness, you can see where the characters are there. A character can combine with different characters to form different words. This little guy, where is he? Well, the one on the far left, and the one where it says population, the thing that goes like that, that means a person. And it can be combined with a number of other different things to form different words. In fact, there are 224 Chinese words that include that particular character. Most words in Chinese are two-character words. Words can be one character, three or four, or sometimes larger than four, but many of the larger words are loan words from European languages. Most of the words, though, are two characters long. Chinese word segmentation sometimes is quite ambiguous, so different segmentations may induce different meanings. So there's a sentence, and that sentence can actually be read as, if you take the first character to be a word on its own, to say the flower grows in the field behind the house, but if you take the first character and combine it with a second character, it says the peanut grows in the field behind the house. And so Chinese readers need to rely heavily on contextual information. When I first went to China, people were trying to tell me virtually everything written in Chinese is like this. That isn't true. There are lots of ambiguities, but it isn't 100% ambiguous. Most of the sentences that Chinese read are not ambiguous like that. The character is the basic unit of Chinese. It's like letters in English. It's almost got this reverence associated with it, particularly by linguists in China who think that, whoa, the character is really where everything is. And there's something really special about characters. I believe there is something special about characters, but the last 10 or 15 years of research has made it very clear that words have psychological reality for Chinese readers, and that the word is probably the basic unit of processing. As I said early on, there are more than 5,000 commonly used Chinese characters. They're different in the following ways. They can be different in the number of strokes that they have. So there's a word, that line there, that says, means one, and it's one stroke. Some characters can have many more strokes than that. The word win, with 17 strokes, is somewhere in the middle in terms of number of strokes associated with the characters. They also differ in terms of the radicals. So the manner of radicals can be combined in different ways to form compound characters. And so the radicals can provide information about meaning, and they can also provide information about how the characters sound. Okay, what do we know about Chinese reading? Well, if we compare it to English, we know the fixation times are about the same. Saccade size is much different, right? So it's 7 to 8 letters in English. It's 2.6 characters in Chinese. But keep in mind that the information is generally much more densely packed in Chinese than it is in English. The regression rate's about the same. Probability of skipping words is about the same. There's some recent work that I heard, people using disappearing text paradigm and finding slightly lower bounds for how long the text has to be there before. If it's shorter than 40 milliseconds, it starts bothering you, but which is a bit shorter than the 50 milliseconds we've found for English. The perceptual span is quite different. It's different on the surface. It's different in that it's one letter to the left of fixation to two or three characters to the right of fixation, which compares rather dramatically with English. But if you think about it in terms of words, they equate out pretty well. For both writing systems, you're basically getting information that you need from the word to the left of fixation, and then two or three to the right, okay? And there's also a preview benefit that's on the same order as it is for English. So when we look at these basic facts about Chinese compared to English, there's some obvious differences here, right? The obvious differences are due to the characteristics of the writing system. But once people have encoded the text, they're probably doing very similar things. Hence, we get word frequency effects. Hence, we get word predictability effects. Hence, a number of other effects that are found in English. The more we learn about Chinese readers, the more similarities to English readers we see. And disappearing text studies are similar. I'll also call your attention to a recent paper that just appeared in JAP General, where we did a large corpus analysis examining how long people look at words as they're reading, and then we also examine are there spillover effects? Are there effects that come from the word that you just left? Are there preview benefit effects that are showing up? And there have been similar large corpus analysis studies done with German and English, and basically what we find with the Chinese study is pretty much the same thing as what was found with the other alphabetic writing systems. So I think the more we learn about Chinese, the more obvious it is in terms of these early processing types of activities where people are trying to figure out what the words are that they're reading are quite similar, the processes across the two writing systems. Some differences in the perceptual span and saccade size due to the nature of orthography, but other than that, things seem to be very similar. How about beginning readers? Well, children at the beginning of the reading process have quite long fixations, short saccades, and they make many regressions. Probably reflects the fact that they are having difficulty decoding the words as they encounter them in reading. They're not experts yet. They don't have a big vocabulary. They don't know a lot of words. A lot of words are hard for them to figure out, and that reflects on how they read. And one of the predictions then is the perceptual span might get shorter for them because they can't spread out their attention as much as people who are more expert can do. Here's some developmental characteristics of eye movements in grades 1 through 4, 5, and 6. Generally, it's assumed that once kids get into about fifth or sixth grade, that their eye movement characteristics are pretty similar to adults. And that's largely true. There are some small differences, but as long as the text is age appropriate, they seem to do okay and look a lot like regression, like adults. There is a steady decline still in the frequency with which regressions are made, but that's getting lower, and if I had eighth and ninth graders in there, it'd probably be about the same as adults. So what about the perceptual span? Well, we did one of these moving window experiments with kids, and here are This stuff's been replicated a couple of times. So here are kids at the end of second grade. And what you see is that the window is pretty much reaching asymptote right around 23 characters. For the older readers, there's some hint that the thing isn't flattening out completely until a bit larger. And these are the adults up here where we again see that when there's 29 characters, there's no difference than the full line. One of the things we did in this experiment was we gave fourth graders text which was too difficult for them. And we did and what we find is the span gets smaller. So whereas they're doing pretty well with text that's easy for them to appropriate for their age level, if you give it to them that's too hard, then their span shrinks down. Again, because they're probably having a lot of difficulty encoding the words falling in their fixation points. Second graders show pretty tiny frequency effects. They don't know yet the difference between lots of the high, they haven't encountered words enough to know what's a high frequency and low frequency word. For fourth graders, the frequency effects on the order of 10 milliseconds or more like 20 milliseconds in gaze duration, which is probably the more important measure. And fifth and sixth graders show frequency effects that are getting pretty close to adults. Second graders show bigger word length effects, that is, they look longer at longer words. They make a lot of refixations, again, because they probably don't know what the words are. And they have earlier landing positions in the text. Disappearing text, this surprised us. This is in Psychology and Aging. We thought that they might need longer to encode the words, but we found that they are basically pretty similar to the skilled readers in terms of how long the text needed to be there. So beginning readers have long fixation times, which I think reflects a difficulty decoding the fixated word. Short saccades, they don't process as much information per fixation as more skilled readers. The perceptual span is smaller than skilled readers, but interestingly, 1 year of reading results in an asymmetric span for the second graders. Just this 1 year of reading and training, you know, moving your eyes consistently from left to right as you're reading the text, results in these moving window experiments of them having a asymmetric span of attention, just like older children and adults do. Little effect of word frequency for second graders, but interestingly, they apparently don't need longer time to encode the text. They do about as well as older readers when they get to see the text for 50 or 60 milliseconds. Around fourth or fifth grade, they start looking more and more comparable to skilled readers, unless the text is too difficult or too hard for them. Okay, let's turn to older readers. This may interest some of you in this room, as a lot of us are getting older. Older readers are slower. First of all, that's just an established fact that's been demonstrated across virtually every aspect of aging that you can think of. Older people are slower. And the slowness starts kicking in around somewhere in the late 30s or 40s. But by the time you're my age or older, then you've clearly slowed down in reading. Older readers have longer fixations. They make, this is interesting, they make longer saccades. Okay, remember with the kids, they made longer fixations, but shorter saccades. Old readers make longer saccades. We've found this a bunch of times in other labs who study older readers have also found this. I'll tell you why in just a second. And they also make more regressions than younger readers or college age readers. They read more slowly. But, interestingly, they do as well, if not better, than young skilled readers on comprehension tests. So we invariably find that the older readers, not always significant because the difference isn't so very big, but across all of the experiments we've published in Psychology and Aging and other aging journals, we pretty much always find this, as do other people, the older readers do better on the comprehension test. They have bigger vocabularies. They may think more deeply about some of the things than the younger readers, but they're slower. There's no doubt about that. The frequency and predictability effects are larger for older readers. They have a bigger vocabulary again, and they know the more differences between lower and higher frequency words. They have a smaller and less asymmetric perceptual span. So they like a little bit more information from the left of fixation as they're reading with these moving windows than do the college age readers. But the span's a little smaller, whereas it's 14 or 15 to the right. For the college age readers, it's more like 12 or 13 to the right for the older readers. And their preview benefit effect is somewhat attenuated. So when we do the boundary experiment with them, whereas I said for college age readers, the range is 25 to 50, the older readers are going to be closer down to that 25 millisecond preview benefit effect. We think that what they do, what older readers do is adopt a riskier reading strategy in which they guess what the next word will be much more than the younger readers do. They know they're going slower. Whether this is a conscious strategy or just a strategy that's sort of an adaptive strategy that they are really not conscious of, I'm not sure, and I don't know if it matters. Probably does, but we haven't figured that one out yet. But they are clearly taking a riskier strategy, guessing what the next word is more frequently. Because text isn't 100% predictable, they're going to be wrong a certain percentage of the time. And this results in them regressing more frequently. Right? So this accounts for the difference between the younger kids and the older readers. Both of them make longer fixations, but the kids make short saccades. The older readers make long saccades, right? And then they regress more frequently. We think it's because of a risky reading strategy that they're adopting to deal with the fact that they know that the cognitive processes in general are slowed down. So older readers have slower processing, they make longer eye fixations, they do need a bit more time to encode the text, not much, but they need, in the disappearing text experiments, they need a bit more time than the younger readers do. They make longer saccades and more regressions than do the college-age readers who we typically compare them to. And they make up for slower processing by guessing more what the next word will be, because they are wrong sometimes and they end up making more regressions. We have successfully simulated the data pattern in the Easy Reader model, taking into account those assumptions that I said about everything is slowed down, so we adjust the parameter value that slows things down. We let them make longer saccades, and they make more regressions. And then when we compare their data with the data from the model and with the college-age readers, the model successfully accounts for their pattern of data. So the Easy Reader model, we have now successfully simulated these data patterns that I've talked about in Chinese readers, beginning readers, and older readers. We have taken a version of the model, made appropriate parameter changes to the model, and can account for the data patterns in these three rather different groups of readers that have very different characteristics. So for the Chinese readers, there's a paper in Cognitive Science in which we modeled reading performance in terms of the eye movements for Chinese readers and successfully account for the data patterns that we see in Chinese readers in the model. For children, there's a recent paper that appeared in Developmental Review in which we use a model, again make changes that are consistent with the data pattern that we have from children, and successfully simulate their data. And in the older readers, there's a paper in Psych and Aging where we successfully simulated that data. On most of these papers, Eric Reichel and Sandy Polacek are co-authors, but there are other people who have joined the group and made various types of simulations and inputs to the model that are also authors on a number of other papers that are published. Okay, I didn't say anything about this in the abstract, but I just do want to make a point of the fact that, okay, so one of the things we've done for a long time, and by the way, we continue doing this. We haven't stopped studying skilled college readers. There's a whole bunch of controversies, and we're right in the middle of a lot of the controversies about what is happening, right? So John mentioned in the introduction that a lot of these preview benefits are due to orthographic and phonological information, and there's no controversy about that. There is controversy about the extent to which the meaning of the word to the right of fixation is being processed when you're looking at word N. Are you getting meaning at all from word N plus one? And for alphabetic writing systems, for a long time, most of the evidence said no. But then the Chinese work came along, and there the Chinese characters are closer to your fixation point, right? And there is some evidence, and also in Chinese, the relationship between the print and the meaning is more transparent than it is in English. And so there's evidence with the Chinese readers that, yeah, they're getting some, and we find this too, they're getting some semantic preview benefits. So now we've gone, and then there were some studies done with German readers that showed such effects. So we've gone back and now we're doing a whole line of investigation to find out where are the situations in which you might find readers getting useful information from the meaning of the word to the right of fixation. And Liz Schotter, who just completed her dissertation in my lab, has shown that if the next word is a synonym, if the preview word is a synonym of the target word, then you can show some preview benefit. And we're trying to map out other situations in which this might happen. We have a paper in press in JEP, HP&P. One big difference between German, where they have been finding some effects, and English, is that all of the nouns in German are capitalized, right? Words in English, most nouns are not capitalized, but there are some that can. Think China, right? The word China can refer to the country or these little China plates and things. And the word ballet, there are some times when we capitalize the word ballet and other times we don't. And the word army, sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. One thing, interesting thing we found was that when the text is all presented in lowercase, with the nouns in lowercase, we get no evidence for semantic associates yielding any type of semantic preview benefit. However, if we use capital, if we use the form of the word where that can be capitalized, as in China and ballet, we find an effect. And what we think is going on is that the capitalized letter is drawing attention to the word more so than lowercase letters do. Interestingly, Dearborn and Dodge suggested, and Huey, back in the late 1900s, suggested that this might be a possibility. The capitalized words would draw attention more than words that are not capitalized. And so we're going systematically through a bunch of possibilities where you might find semantic preview benefits. So we're right in the middle of the biggest debate in the field. So I didn't mean to imply we've stopped doing research on skilled readers, because we keep doing it. Much of our work is there. But we've also been doing this, I think, interesting research on deaf readers. Most of you are probably aware that most adult deaf readers in this country they have pretty poor reading skills. When they leave high school, they're reading at about fourth, fifth grade level on average. But there are some good readers, And so what we've done is studied the perceptual span in good and less skilled deaf readers, and they show interesting results. In fact, this paper was published in Psychological Science. And so here again is our moving window. And so you have moving windows of words, 6 characters to the right of fixation, 10 to the right, 14 to the right, 18 to the right, and no window, meaning the whole line is there. And so what we find is our normal increase in reading rate as the window gets bigger. The bottom line represents the less skilled deaf readers. These would be the people who are probably reading somewhere between 5th, 6th, 7th grade level when they leave high school. The sentences are pretty easy. We didn't want to make things too hard for them. Everybody's reading the same sentences. Then we have the normal skilled readers. These are the college students. They're not college students, sorry. They are matched on age and reading level to the skilled deaf readers. There's a bit of an anomaly there where the reading rate drops off a little bit between 14 and 18 to the no window condition for the skilled readers, but that's pretty much an anomaly. We've done other experiments where it just goes flat. So basically what we're seeing with the skilled hearing readers is pretty much the same thing we always see. But notice that with the highly skilled deaf readers, these are adults, not college students, they're all adults in the community, and you can see that the window, the perceptual span for them, is bigger. That's a significant difference there. So the difference at when there's 18 letters to the right of fixation is significantly different from the control readers. And Nathalie Berthier-Bélanger, who is the lead author on this paper, is currently busting her butt in not far from here at Fremont, a school for the deaf, where we are testing a bunch of kids who are deaf readers to see how early this thing kicks in for highly skilled deaf readers. So I think this is a pretty interesting result, and we've done a number of other things with deaf readers as well. So in summary, I've talked about Chinese readers, beginning readers, older readers, and deaf readers. I think it's important to study all of them in their own right, but they also provide interesting comparisons to college-age readers, I would argue. Thanks very much for your attention. If you have questions, I'd be happy to take them. Thank you. Yeah. I can't hear you. I'm sorry. Does that mic work?
With the deaf readers, you're comparing the very elite of the deaf to the average of the others. Are there some hearing people who would be equivalent to the deaf?
Now, that's an interesting question, and we've got this kind of stuff on reviews all the time. It would be hard to find college-age readers who are reading about like the deaf, less skilled readers, because they would probably have been categorized as dyslexic.
And so, but would you find hearing readers who would be equivalent to the to the skilled deaf?
Would we find hearing readers who are equivalent to the skilled deaf?
Because the skilled deaf are like special people, right?
Right. We have not found any groups where the perceptual span is larger than about 14 or 15 characters for college-age readers.
Okay,
but for less skilled college-age readers, they would look much like the less skilled deaf readers.
Okay, but within any group, there's presumably variation. Some are better
sure.
than others.
Yeah, of course.
Would the best of the hearing readers be equivalent to the skilled
deaf? I see what you're saying. Yeah, there'd be a couple that would, yeah.
Hi, that was great.
Thank you.
So I heard an NPR the other day about the influx of e-readers in the market.
Spritz.
What's Spritz?
Okay, well, go ahead. Go ahead.
They had two researchers on, people who are studying whether people prefer to use e-readers or traditional paper, and also some of the effects on comprehension. Mm. So I'm just wondering, Keith, if you have any plans of moving in this direction, because there is some literature that I've seen already about how people learn more from paper than they do from the e-readers, and to what extent some of the processes that you study become perhaps degraded or maybe not when people are using e-readers.
I think if you're talking about e-readers and like Kindle and things like that, there's probably not a lot of difference, because most of our experiments, in fact, are done on computer screens. And so I think that that's pretty similar. Where I think there's a big difference, not what I thought you were referring to at first, is all of this stuff about speed reading using these apps called, one of them is called Spritz, where words are flashed one at a time very fast with a red line, they call it, that it's supposed to tell you this is the best place in the word to be. This is all bogus. They are basically repeating things that we've known for 40 years and trying to make some money out of this, but we just have an article submitted and accepted the same day in Psychological Science, showing that with those kind of apps, where you can't look back, reading goes to pieces. Mike Masson showed this 30 years ago, but now, you know, they have on their webpage this stuff about, oh, research supports all of this, and there's all this research, and they imply that they've done the research. They haven't done anything. They've read a bunch of papers and got most of it wrong. They say, for example, that 90% of the time your eyes are moving, and the other 10% of the time you're processing the information. Wrong way around, guys. Your eyes are moving about 10% of the time and are still for the other 90% of the time. I thought that's what you were referring to, and there are lots of problems with that. Yeah, hi.
Hi, congratulations on your award.
Thank you.
Are you willing to speculate on what might be the effect of texting that's happening in the younger generation, where the balance is changing, that's more emphasis on the phonology, less emphasis on its relationship to orthography, and how that might actually be beneficial in English where it's a deep orthography, or maybe not beneficial?
That's an interesting question. I don't know how much I would want to speculate on that. I do think that the study that I mentioned that was done in German, where nouns are always capitalized in German, they're not capitalized when you text, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that may be why they found in their study that they got semantic preview benefit even when capital letters weren't used. I don't know what the effect, I mean, I have students in my lab who are interested in this kind of thing, and so I think there may be more work done on it. I'm always reluctant to speculate because I'm too often wrong when I speculate, and I'd rather figure out what the data are first. It's an interesting question, though. Okay, thank you.